future growth in common, we can't really decide what our next step is. If we're just following the pacing guide and assuming kids are getting it, and waiting till the CST, finding out they've moved on to another grade and they really didn't get this, then we've got gaps and holes that are harder to address.
I have to say our teachers are really doing a great job in terms of developing their capacity. So one example I'm going to use is our middle school math teachers, who's been going through the training actually since last year, you know, transitioning to a Common Core. And I know some of you had a chance to actually visit some of the training. So in June, they are going to get together by grade level and look at the assessments. And actually, we have some assessments and look at how to align to a Common Core. Because now they have a deeper understanding. They know about depth of knowledge, you know, the Bloom's taxonomy. So they're going to be working on that in June. So they are developing much higher level assessment items.
So is it the notion of assessment, because that's number three, is in the bolded goal up here, is varied assessment of practices. So is the idea in assessment to do more than paper and pencil, or is the idea to go to standardized assessments that we can then measure across the district, third grade performance, or
all of the above?
I think it's a comprehensive
varied
assessment.
Is the key in there. It's not just paper
exactly.
and pencil.
It's
and it's part of the instructional strategies.
And
of
even
assessment. It happens immediately. It's part of the RTI squared. It happens immediately, so we can adjust and repeat.
And I think that teachers are pretty masterful at doing this and not even necessarily calling an assessment when they do sort of a checking for understanding. And what we want to do more of is use that information at the moment to adjust. So I don't think that teachers have always thought that there are moment-to-moment interactions in the classroom as assessment, but if you think about it, and you're watching and observing how our kids are taking things in, then you can adjust in that. So that can be assessment. Group projects, presentations, a lot more performance assessment. So I think it's understanding that assessment is a much broader picture than just this comprehensive benchmark or, you know, this end of semester final.
And so our three-year plan, which are, you know, would include a variety of, you might have those common benchmark assessments in writing that you can standardize, but you're including a focus on some other earlier assessment and adjustment.
Right. What we would envision, there would be like perhaps four quarterly district assessments that we could compare. And then each side would generically create their own assessments for their teachers. Right? And that's just part of the whole CLC journey. Perhaps like when we went to school, we didn't, our parents didn't get through grades until progress reports or report cards, which was 8 or 9 weeks down the road, and we're just losing too many kids during that span. So now it's not only 2 or 3 weeks, but like Susan was saying, on a daily basis, just checking for understanding, whether it's whiteboards, response clickers, thumbs up, thumbs down, those types of things.
So I'm hearing exciting conversation amongst teachers around this, so I appreciate the work that's going on. My one question or concern is we don't have textbooks for the Common Core yet, and I do know that there are faculties across the district that are looking at different materials now that things are a little bit, I'll also use the word looser in regards to. So the assessments would be based on reaching certain standards at certain time rather than looking at what's available in textbooks. Is that correct? Or then you explain the correlation there, because as the State Board of Education finally gets around to adopting textbooks and curriculum, we may have to change, and how quickly will we be able to change?
And I think that's a really good question, and teachers have been asking. I know we've been talking about it because, you know, traditionally we really have depended on adopting a series or, you know, a publisher's approach to teaching the standards. And now that's not out there yet. And even whether it will be or when it will be, we're not sure.
Well, the math adoption is now 2014. Mm-hmm. You jump ahead of the legislative clock. But I'm going to use another an example of how we're addressing that. And I'm using secondary math because they're the farthest along. So what teachers have been doing is taking the Common Core standards and looking at the textbooks that they have. Now, math it's a lot easier, you know, because you know the concepts of perimeter and aerialism don't change. So they've been aligning it, you know, looking at what's already in their textbooks that would align with the Common Core. So that's the what part, what standards would they be? What we're really trying to focus on is the math practice part. That's going to be the biggest shift with our secondary. But as far as materials, so if you're teaching area and perimeter, using that as an example, that's the concept. But how we've been doing it may be, you know, formula driven. Whereas, you know, the change in practice is going to be building conceptual understanding. So that's the part that we're really working on and looking at, you know, higher level questions and hands-on, all of those. So we're doing that with our secondary folks. And you know, we continue to do that with other grade levels. So even without the textbooks, you know, it is that that's probably it's manageable.
Mm-hmm.
The math is going to be coming, the adoption is going to be coming in first. Because it's really going to be focused on practice. It's not just a two-page spread in a textbook.
And some of those textbook publishers were looking at supplemental materials rather than a whole new adoption. I don't know.
Well, the bridge materials
where
we saw
that
was
not good.
Not good.
Because I haven't looked at those yet.
Yes, those
well,
are not good.
The other thing, I think math is a little bit easier that we can look at what we already have. And really, teachers, if they are working with the standards, can say this addresses that concept or this addresses that. In language arts, I think it's maybe a little bit more challenging because what we're really looking at in Common Core is comparing pieces of information. So it won't necessarily just be a textbook. That would be one resource. But what do we pull from different media? And what authentic text can we pull from, you know, actual historical speeches rather than a textbook author's impression of what happened in that event? So, again, it's a much richer and broader and deeper use of materials. And I don't know that one textbook will be able to fill all those needs, but the other thing that Common Core really emphasizes is we need to be really aware of students' reading levels and moving them up in text complexity. So we need to be able to assess where they are, but if you have one textbook and you know we all open at page 35, for some kids, they're well able to integrate that information because they are at that level of reading. For other kids, they maybe need a lot more support. So how can we pull materials at different levels of text complexity and continue to assess where kids are and move them up? It may not be one textbook. That would be hard to. So it's how to support teachers in knowing where resources are, how to pull them, and how to collaborate so that, you know, Stephen finds these great resources for his third grade class, and I can use them, but not only that, but across the district, we've got a professional learning community of third grade teachers who are sharing. And we've used our website and, you know, all different teachers are really seeing how that collaboration can help replace the fact that they don't have that one textbook. So it's
you've been doing level reading for years at the elementary. I mean, you've got those resources.
We do. We do, but again, I think we've been a little bit limited in that we've had one textbook, mm-hmm. and we've been doing reading, and for example,
we'll shift to fiction texts.
Right. And that's a great example that teachers are now using some of their science materials and social studies materials for reading, but we're also looking at a fifth grade science text that may be written at a ninth grade text complexity level. So what we're learning is we can't just